One of Jesus' profound questions is, what do you want me to do for you? What do you want me to do for you is a pretty common question. You walk into a retail store and somebody will say, what can I do for you? How can I help you? Go to a restaurant, server will ask you, you know, what can I do for you? What can I get you? Jump in an Uber or Lyft or taxi cab and person will say, you know, what can I do for you? Where do you want to go? Go to a medical facility, doctor will ask, what can I do for you? But when Jesus asks, what do you want me to do for you? It's like we pause and think, well, how should I answer? We all have things we want to happen in our lives. We have hopes and dreams for love and meaning and significance. Gerald May writes, in The Awakened Heart, there is a desire within each of us in the deep center of ourselves that we call our heart. We were born with it. It is never completely satisfied and it never dies. We are often unaware of it, but it is always awake. Our true identity, our reason for being, is to be found in this desire. God has written dreams into our hearts. To lose heart is to lose everything. It's to give up our dreams for the future. We don't want to get cut off from our heart because that's like the roadmap God has given us for our lives. You know, you ask some people how things are going, they say, same old, same old. That's sad. Now think about your life. Have things gone the way you hoped they would? What do you want? You say, I want healing. Maybe there's something, you know, going on physically or medically. Or, you know, you want hope for your marriage. You say, God, I don't know what to do. Or maybe you're worried about a son or a daughter. You say, God, help me. Or you want a better job. Or you say, I want friends. God, I don't really have any friends. Or you want help with school. The sad thing is that many of us abandon our dreams. We settle for second best. We lose heart. We brush off the whispers for joy with a cynical, been there, done that. We resign ourselves to the ideas, I guess that's all there is. We go to work, come home, make some dinner, feed the dog, watch a bit of news, go to bed, just to get up and do it all over again the next day. We leave our hearts by the side of the road and we move in the direction of hopelessness. Oscar Wilde wrote, we did not dare to breathe a prayer or give our anguish scope. Something was dead in each of us, and what was dead was hope. God doesn't want us to settle into hopelessness. In the midst of our despair, Jesus asks, what do you want me to do for you? We're not sure how to answer. Because for many of us, we've cut ourselves off from our dreams. Enter into the time tunnel and travel with me back to first century Palestine. He sits by the side of the road, almost motionless. Small old bowl lays in front of him. For people who want to take pity on him to toss their spare change. He wears a cloak over his head. This isn't just any kind of cloak. Lepers cry out unclean so people can know they're lepers and not get too close. And this cloak, which is kind of like a hoodie, lets them know that this is a blind person without them having to look into their tragic blindness. He hears a big commotion as people are coming in his direction. He thinks, somebody ought to notice my plight. Maybe this will be a good day for me. He asks what's going on? Somebody says, it's Jesus of Nazareth, the prophet and healer. He's heard of Jesus. Jesus broke the bread for 5,000. He heals lepers and gives speech to the mute. He raises the dead. He heals the blind. He heals the blind, he thinks. Maybe he could heal me. And so he cries out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Any good Jew knows that the Messiah will be the Son of David. So anybody around him, hearing him say this, knows that he believes he's the Messiah. Shh. People close to him scold. He doesn't have time for you. But he cries all the louder, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stops and says, call him. Quick, get up. People near him say, cheer up, he's calling you. So he throws off his cloak and he jumps up. And Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you? He stands there speechless. Slowly the words seep into his consciousness like a voice calling him out of a dream. What do you want me to do for you? Slowly, like a wheel long rusted, his mind begins to turn over. What kind of question is that? Why wouldn't I cry out to him? Why wouldn't I sit by the city gate begging day after day? He's mocking me. This guy's had his share of ridicule. Hey there, blind man, would you like to be able to look around and see things? Who dares ask something so callous? It's Jesus who poses the question, but so there must be something we're missing. He loves us, doesn't he? Why does he ask the blind man such an insensitive question? I mean, the guy's blind. It's clear what he wants, isn't it? It's obvious. Or is it? Jesus is probing for something we do not see. He knows the answer, of course, but does the man? Do we? Think of the blind man for your moment. Just put yourself in his shoes. His whole life has been built around his brokenness. For him, there's only one thing he wants. He doesn't care about riches. He doesn't want fame. His whole life, he's only wanted one thing. When other kids went out, he stayed inside or stood on the sidelines and listened. At what point did he begin to lose hope? After a year? Maybe after 2 years? How about after 5 years or 10? How long can you go on dreaming when you face continual disappointment? I think at some point, this man, like all of us, began to lose hope and began to cut himself off from his dreams. Calluses had formed. Not on Jesus' heart, but on this man's. He'd given up on his dream. Jesus took him back into the secret of his heart. By asking him what he wants, he brings this man back to his dreams. After what seems like an eternity, the man answers, Jesus, I want to see. Go. Jesus said, your faith has made you well. And he got up and he walked along the road with Jesus. This is the last healing miracle Mark records before Jesus goes to the cross. You say, how can we know this actually happened. I mean, healing a blind person is pretty big. It's a good question. How do we know this actually happened or any of the other miracles attributed to Jesus? Let me share a few reasons why I believe we can believe Jesus did miracles. One, the miracles are woven into the fabric of the Gospels. Much of Jesus' teaching presupposes a miracle. Jesus feeds the 5,000. Then he says, I'm the bread of life. He heals the blind man. Then he teaches that he's the light of the world. He raises Lazarus from the dead, and then he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Take away the miracle, and much of his teaching goes down the drain as well. Two, Jesus went down in history, in secular history, as a miracle worker. What possible reason would secular historians have for telling us that Jesus had performed miracle unless they had good sources that told them that he had? Three, the faith of the early church is hard to explain away. The firm faith of the early church that Jesus performed miracles is hard to understand if he hadn't, in fact, done so. I mean, how could tens of thousands of people been deluded into believing, and then eventually hundreds of thousands of people into believing something that Jesus never did? Most scholars believe that the Apostle Paul wrote his first letters in the late 40s and the rest of them in the 50s and then into the early 60s. The Gospels, we believe that Mark was written in the late 50s and then Luke was written early 60s, and that Matthew and John were written before 70 AD when Jerusalem fell, because none of the Gospels mentions the fall of Jerusalem. That means if Jesus died 30 or 33 AD, all these were written like 30 years after these epistles and Gospels were written, 30 years after Jesus died, when there were lots of eyewitnesses walking around. That if they were claiming something was false, they could say, hey, wait a minute, I was a follower, I saw him, he didn't do any miracles. The fact that there is no one who disputes that Jesus did miracles serves as evidence that the miracles did in fact happen. And four, there is the resurrection. The Christian faith is built around the amazing claim that God raised Jesus from the dead. The resurrection is one of the best attested facts in all of ancient history. It has the good evidence of the empty tomb. You say, you don't believe Jesus rose from the dead? Look in the tomb, it's empty. The appearances to over 500 people in a court of law, if you have one or two witnesses, that's considered a good case. And we have over 500. And then the transformation of the disciples. They were cowards. They were lacking in courage. And all of a sudden they became bold preachers about Jesus being raised from the dead. If you believe the resurrection, it's no problem to believe the other miracles. The resurrection declares Jesus to be the Son of God. And believe me, it's no problem for the Son of God to do miracles. Jesus called the blind man and asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" He wants the man to get in touch with his dreams and state his request. Jesus wants us to get in touch with our dreams, because God put them there as a roadmap for our life. How can we get in touch with our deepest desires and verbalize them? I find five things in this healing of the blind man that can help us become people that get in touch with our deepest feelings and desires and be able to state them. First, don't give up so easily. When the blind man cried for help, people around him said, "Shh." He could have just backed away and went off in self-pity, but he kept crying out. He didn't give up. Most of us give up far too quickly. We pray a prayer, it's not answered, so we bag it. We read the Bible a few times, nothing big happens in our life, so we put it away. Let it collect dust. We serve, try to serve God in some way, and then somebody criticizes us and we say, I'm done with that. Odds are good that the leading salespeople in most companies in the United States lose more sales than most other salespeople in their company. Walt Disney went broke 7 times and had a wondrous breakdown before success smiled on him. Successful people are often those that just keep at it. They don't have more charisma. They're not smarter. They just keep going. Motivational speaker Zip Ziglar says, the major difference between the big shot and the little shot is the big shot is just a little shot who kept on shooting. Keep on praying for your heartfelt dreams. Keep on reading the Bible and studying it and telling God what you want for your life. Keep on serving. I can't tell you it's going to be easy. Life is not easy. There will be setbacks, but keep at it. Wendy May gave me this story, a month ago. Wendy's sitting over here. Wave your hand, Wendy. Wendy gave her life to Christ, I think sitting right where she is today. Wendy hasn't had an easy life. She has myotonic dystrophy. It's a progressive disease, a gradual deterioration of the muscles. That's why she's in a scooter. Her older sister died a couple years ago at age 44 of the same thing she has. So she lives in fear of what's going to happen to me. Knowing her story gives this story more meaning. A couple went to England for their 25th wedding anniversary. They both liked antiques and pottery, and especially teacups. They found a classic little shop with a lovely selection of teacups. Spotting an exceptional cup, they asked, "May we see it? We've never seen a cup quite so beautiful." As the lady handed it to them, the teacup spoke. It was a little weird. "You don't understand," it said. "I have not always been a teacup. There was a time when I was just a lump of clay. My master took me and rolled me and pounded and patted me all over and over, and I yelled out, 'Don't do that. I don't like it. Let me alone.' But he smiled and gently said, 'Not yet.' Then wham, I was placed on a spinning wheel and spun around and around and around. 'Stop it. I'm so dizzy. I'm going to be sick.' But the master only nodded and said quietly, 'Not yet.' He spun and poked and prodded and bent me out of shape, and then he put me in the oven. I never felt such heat. I yelled and knocked and pounded on the door, 'Help, get me out of here.' I could see him through the glass, and I could read his lips as he shook his head from side to side, 'Not yet.' When I thought I couldn't bear it another minute, the door opened. He carefully took me out and put me on the shelf, and I began to cool. 'This feels so good,' I thought, but after I cooled, he picked me up and brushed and painted me all over. The fumes were horrible. I thought I would gag. 'Oh, please, stop it, stop it,' I cried. He only shook his head and said, 'Not yet.' Then he put me back in the oven, only it was not like it was before. This time it was twice as hot, and I just knew I would suffocate. I begged, I pleaded, I screamed, I cried. Just then the door opened, and he took me out and again placed me on the shelf where I cooled. An hour later, he handed me a mirror and said, 'Look at yourself.' I said, 'That's not me. It couldn't be me. It's beautiful. I'm beautiful.' He spoke quietly, 'I want you to remember when you were rolled and pounded and patted. If I had left you alone, you would have dried up. I know it made you dizzy to spin around on the wheel, but if I had stopped, you would have crumbled. I know it was hot and disagreeable in the oven, but if I hadn't put you in there, you would have cracked. I know the fumes were bad when I brushed and painted you, but if I hadn't, you wouldn't have survived for long because the hardness would not have held. Now you are a finished teacup. Now you are what I had in mind when I first began with you. God knows what he's doing with each of us. He's the potter and we are his clay. He will mold us and expose us to just enough pressure so that we may be made into a flawless piece of work to fulfill his will for us. So when life seems hard and you're being pounded and patted and pushed beyond your endurance, when your world seems to be spinning out of control, when you are in a fiery furnace of trials, take a minute and brew a cup of your favorite tea in your prettiest teacup. I think this was written by a woman. What do you think? Prettiest teacup, Chuck? What do you think? Then sit down and have a little talk with the potter. God doesn't promise an easy life. Things will be hard. You may suffer, but trust God. He'll bring good things out of the bad. Second, verbalize your heartfelt desires to Christ. Jesus asked the blind man what he asked every one of us. What do you want me to do for you? What do you want in your life with your family? With your business, with your school, with your church? Why are we so embarrassed by our dreams and desires? Why do we pretend we're doing fine? Thank you very much. Say we don't need anything. I ask some people sometimes, how can I pray for you? And they say, I don't really need anything. Come on. Until we're able to get in touch with our feelings and tell Christ what we want, we're not probably going to experience answers to prayer. Paul Yonggi Cho, pastor of the largest church in the world in Seoul, Korea, with over 1 million members, says, you know, when I began, things weren't going so well. Then I felt like God told me to ask for specific things. He says, only when I began to do that did things begin to happen. You see, it's only when we ask for specific things that we can know if God answers. I mean, if you say, God, help me today, I don't know, how are you going to know if he answered that? But if you say, would you please specifically, could you bring about this? And then if it happens, you could say, you know what? God did that. If we don't ask specific things, we'll never know if he answered, and so then we won't ever give him the credit, we won't give him the glory. Three, cry out to God for mercy. This is so important. The blind man said, Jesus, have mercy on me. When you cry out to God for mercy, you're praying a very good prayer. David prays, remember, Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. In other words, God has always been merciful. Do not remember the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you, Lord, are good. In other words, you're merciful. When you ask God for mercy, it's a strong prayer because you're asking him to be who he already is. It's probably the way Jory and I pray more than any other single way. Four, take the plunge of faith in Christ. When the blind Bartimaeus heard Jesus coming, he cried out to Jesus for mercy because he believed Jesus was his only hope. He'd been blind his whole life. But he believed Jesus could heal him. You know, over the last several weeks, you've heard us ask many profound questions Jesus asked. One of them is, who do you say I am? At some point, you have to answer that question. If you believe he's the Son of God, Lord of the universe, isn't it time to step out in faith and tell him that and invite him to be first in your life? To the woman who had been the subject of bleeding for 12 years, she thought, if I can just touch the edge of his clothes, I'll be healed. And then she did, and she was healed, and Jesus turned and says, daughter, your faith has made you well. To this blind man who said, Jesus, have mercy on me, and Jesus healed him, he said, go, your faith has made you well. It's God who heals us. It's God who does transformation in our lives, but we have to believe. We have to put our faith in him. That's our part. It's easy to not put faith in him and never give him any credit. never give thanks to God. You know, that's actually, that's, here's my next point. So don't give up too easily. Verbalize specifically what you want Jesus to do. Cry out to God for mercy. Take the plunge of faith. And finally, cultivate thankfulness. Jesus healed this blind man, and Mark says, immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus, praising God. He praised Jesus. He gave him the credit. The fact that Mark calls him by name, that he was Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, tells us that he stayed with the church and he became well known in the church, so everybody would recognize who he was. He was thankful to Jesus for healing his eyes. If we're not going to give God credit when he answers our prayers, why should he grant our prayers? It's easy for us to never give him thanks. We play heads I win, tails you lose. If you pray for something and it happens, you say, heads I win, I did it myself. I just got lucky. If you don't get your answer, you say, tails you lose. You lose, God. You're terrible. You don't care about me. Either way, God gets no credit. What do you want me to do for you is the question I believe Jesus is asking every one of us in the room today. What in your wildest dreams do you want him to do for you? I want you to, would you take your program, Profound Questions? We put a piece of paper in there today, and I'd like you to pull that out. Take a pen. There's a pen in front of every seat in front of you. I'd like you to write a note to God. Just start it off, Dear God, and tell him what you want. Answer the question, what do you want me to do for you? I think this may be the most important thing you do today. So I'm going to write one too. So would you all just pull this out? Try to get in touch with what do you really want in your life and tell him right now. This is not a selfish letter. I mean, Jesus is the one who asks us the question, what do you want me to do for you? Now this is us answering that question, okay? I want you, every one of you, to write. All right, you're probably not done, but we can't sit here all morning. So I'd like you to take this, put it wherever you're going to see it. And I don't know if that's your Bible. And I want you to finish this, and then I want you to pray it every day, if you would. I think you're going to see some amazing things happen if you will specifically tell God what you'd like him to do in your life. All right? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for asking this question. Seems like a silly question, an almost insensitive question. It's obvious what a blind man wants, but I guess it wasn't. And you want us to do the same kind of searching of what is it we really want. So help us to get in touch and to tell you what we want the rest of our lives and see some great things happen and then give you the praise and have a much closer relationship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.